Hi, my name is Shing Yin Khor. I'm an installation artist and cartoonist, and this is where I work.
I'm going to show you a bunch of the processes and tools that I used while making my graphic novel, The Legend of Auntie Po.
I should probably tell you what this book is actually about, so the rest of this video is going to make sense when I talk about it. I'm going to read the back. In a Sierra Nevada logging camp in 1885, 13-year-old May bakes the most delicious pies and tells the best stories, which happen to be reimagined Paul Bunyan myths starring Po Pan Yin, Auntie Po, an elderly Chinese matriarch. In the midst of racial tumult following the passage of the Chinese Exclusion Act, May tries to remain blissfully focused on her job, her close friendship with Bee, the camp foreman's daughter, and her stories. Until one day, Auntie Po and her giant blue water buffalo, Pei Pei, come to life to help May navigate the difficulty and politics of lumber camp work and her growing romantic feelings for Bee. An exploration of who gets to own a myth, The Legend of Auntie Po is a hopeful portrayal of how immigrant communities hold on to tradition while staking out their own place in America. It's my book! I feel like it's important to show you my Paul Bunyan research board, which, while not necessarily directly related to Auntie Po itself, definitely formed a lot of the basis for my research and work. This printout right here, Legends of Paul Bunyan, Lumberjack, K. Bernice Stewart, and Homer A. Watt, is actually the first academic paper ever written about Paul Bunyan myths. These here are illustrations by W.B. Lawhead, who was the man who actually popularized the Paul Bunyan myth. And he did it because he was a marketing guy, essentially. He put Paul Bunyan stories in all of these, pamphlets going out to lumberjacks, because he worked for the Red River Lumber Company, which was a lumber company. So I've got a couple other, you know, Paul Bunyan related bits here. These are lots of my notes on the evolution of the Paul Bunyan myths, on William Lawhead, on Bernice Stewart, on racial diversity in logging camps. This is a little blue babe head that my friend Leslie Loving sculpted. Look at him. What a little good little dude. Here is actually one of the very first Paul Bunyan drawings that I ever made. It's very old. It's like 5 years old now. I think that's mostly it. Oh wait, one more thing. Corey Bing sent me this guy. I felt it was important to show you. He's got a little chainsaw. This is the Paul Bunyan related part of my library, of my bookshelf, which does not actually even include all of the books on Chinese, on the history of Chinese people in America. So that's another whole pile. I make comics using a hybrid digital and traditional process. So these are the pages, the inked pages for my book, Legend of Auntie Po. And this is what, whoops. Ah, wait, there. This is what my sketches look like, generally. I don't really have a pencil stage. I go directly to inks from this point. So that's what it looks like without the sketch layer. And that's the first page of my book. I paint traditionally using watercolor, so I have a lot of paint. So right before I start a book, I actually narrow down a palette for the colors I'm going to use. So here's an example of the colors that I chose for Auntie Po. I figure out exactly what color I'm using for clothing, skin color, hair, even things like grass. And I set aside those colors in these two palettes. So every color on this page, whether it's mixed, is in one of these two palettes, which means that in the process of painting a book, I will put everything else away.
So I spent about a whole year not looking at any colors but these. Something that I'm really delighted about is that the title treatment for The Legend of Auntie Po is actually hand-carved block print, which I carved myself very slowly. Let me show you how this ends up looking. Whoops. All right, let me show you now that I actually have paper to show you with. As you can see, stamps actually need to be carved backwards. So even after having carved all of these stamps right here, here's the whole pile of stamps that I carved out for the title, I had to scan everything and then flip them in Photoshop, because I did not realize before starting my carving process that they needed to be carved backwards. But it turned out great anyway, and I am so excited at what we were able to do.
Hey, Bob, come here. Come here. Get my baby. This is my dog. Her name is Bug. And she's the most special girl in the whole world. Aren't you the most special girl in the whole world? Look at you. Gah! I love you so much. I love you. You're perfect.
So, would you like to talk about axes?
So, my book is set in a logging camp, and I do draw several axes in the book itself. And as a result, I ended up acquiring a fair number of axes as, you know, research.
Yes, those are axes. Do you want me to tell you about them? Well, they're axes. Not really sure what I can tell you about. This is a throwing axe. Do you know it's a throwing axe? These two axes are standard hand axes. Obviously, this one is in significantly better condition than this vintage axe that I acquired. But these are generally used for just splitting wood. They're about a foot and a half long, which is a little shorter than a felling axe is. A felling axe is what you can actually use for taking down trees, and they're usually quite a bit longer, and their heads are a little bigger. I don't have one, so I can't show you. This axe here is a modern throwing axe. You can see how it is theoretically a lot more streamlined than throwing an actual hand axe. It's quite a lot lighter as well.
So early in quarantine, I built my own axe throwing range behind my house. You can tell by the marks on it that maybe this is not my skill set. Oh. This one is one of my absolute favorites. So the axe part is pretty self-explanatory, but it's got hammer on the back. So this is called a, you know, I'm not actually sure what it's called. It's sometimes called a wallboard axe, because this little section here helps pull nails out of drywall or wood. It's sometimes called a carpenter's axe. I like calling it a hammer axe because it is very self-explanatory. There's a hammer on one end and an axe head on the other. My favorite, truly my favorite. This big boy here is a fireman's axe. It's about 3 feet long, and it's a standard fireman's axe. Firemen carry them for chopping wood in burning buildings. It's what firemen do, as far as I know.
This is a big axe. It's pretty big. This one's small. This is a plastic axe from the Halloween store.
Okay, but this is a, it's a hand axe, it's a hatchet, but look at how cool it is. This is a True Temper Jet Rocket hand axe, and just look at this handle detail. Look at that pretty curve. This is such a cool axe. It's seriously rad.
I bet no one really has a problem with me talking about axes all day. However, I can also talk about saws. So in one of the chapter headers for my book, I wrote about some saws often used in logging camps for cutting down trees. And I really wanted to get in some fairly specific details because, I don't know, it's important. It's important to know how saws work. And saws are interesting. So, this is a vintage crosscut saw. It is, let's see how tall it is. It is 5 feet tall, just about my height, right there. And this is big. This is the kind of saws that they use to cut down trees. The good stuff. So you can see on the saw itself exactly what I was trying to explain in my illustration. So over here, you can see that the teeth alternate, and that's very straightforward. It's because, well, these hand saws move back and forth. So you want it to be able to cut in both directions. And these over here are raking teeth. And what they do is clean the sawdust out. So you get a clean cut and everything is just, you know, so much easier. And you can actually see this in modern... Whoops, dropped the phone. But you can see this in modern saws as well. Let me bring this a little bit closer. In this case, this is a pretty fine saw, so you don't really need any raking teeth. It just kind of does its own work, but you can still see that they're alternating. And for context, it's actually cool to look at a modern saw. This is my chop saw. But if you look closely at the teeth, you'll actually see that they do not alternate. That's because it's not necessary. The blade on a chop saw only goes in one direction. It never goes backwards.
Well, we are not done talking about logging tools yet. I will use these pages because the arc's not in color. All right. So one of the most common tools that were used in logging camps is the peavey, just this. And this was used for moving logs, for grabbing logs, for rolling logs. And a peavey consists of two parts. One is a jam pike, which is the spike at the very end of this pole, and the cant hook, which is a movable steel hook used to grab and roll logs. Combined, they create the peavey, which is incredibly versatile. You can push logs with it, you can grab logs with it, and it's just, you know, a really nice, solid, intimidating looking object. Now, I do not have one of these, which is truly a shame, but I do have some parts of it. Let's see. All right. So this here is a cant hook, but considering how versatile it is, they really should call it the can hook. I am so sorry. And the one I have is a little too rusty to actually swivel, but you can see how it would look if attached to one of these poles. And this little spiky end right here would stab into a log and make it a lot easier to move them. Look at it. What a lovely object. My book isn't just about lumberjacks. It actually primarily focuses on camp cooks. So it was really important for me to not just draw the tools of labor associated with felling trees, but also with all labor involved in a logging camp, which in this case includes the kitchen. So I actually drew a lot of these based on my experiences as an artist in residence at Homestead National Monument in Beatrice, Nebraska. And I drew a lot of this directly from a display that was in their museum. And so I've got some kitchen tools too, but we all know what those look like. Well, that's a frying pan. Cast iron pan, just like they used to use. Sorry, it's a little dirty. I literally just made my lunch in it. Long chopsticks. My characters use these longer chopsticks quite often in the book. And they're super helpful because you can sort of, you know, keep your hands away from the fire. And finally, one of the kitchen objects most common in the book, a wok. Real great for stir-frying things. If you don't own one, I recommend it.
I love this dog more than anything else.
And she's such a good shop dog. Aren't you a good shop dog?
Good enough!